The district's reassessment yielded a total increase in our assessed valuation of 7.7%. Prior to 2008, the typical increase in our assessed valuation in the reassessment year would be closer to 14%, or almost double what we're seeing this year. Our district's assessed valuation grew due to new construction, but at a lower rate than prior to the recession. Our revenue growth as a result of reassessment is limited to the lesser of 5%, or the consumer price index as calculated by the state auditor. For 2017, the CPI was determined to be 2.1%. This slide provides a breakdown of the assessed valuation by category. District homeowners account for over 72% of the district's total assessed valuation. Commercial accounts equal roughly 12% of our assessed valuation. Personal property accounts for 15%. Agricultural and railroad and utility account for less than 1%. This slide shows the changes in the district's assessed value over time. Note again the growth levels in prior reassessment cycles. The growth in our AV affects not just our operating funds, but the debt service fund as well. These are the proposed tax rates by fund for 2017. In our incidental fund, $2.1069. In our teachers fund, $2.1445. In our capital projects fund, 6 cents. And on our debt service fund, 67.13 cents, for a total of $4.8527 cents. If we compare the proposed rates to the prior years, we'll see that our overall rate is being lowered by almost 17 cents. This comes as a result of the reassessment and the requirement of the Hancock Amendment that we roll back our rate so that we only collect additional revenue on existing property equal to the CPI or 5%, whichever is less. And so for this year, for us, that's 2.1%. So we have to roll our rate back based on the growth in assessed value. We've shared information with the board previously on tax rates, first in April with the projected tax liability notice, and then last month when we conducted our workshop on the tax rate. And so while there have been some fluctuations because assessed value is constantly changing within the district, it's fairly consistent. So we anticipated that in April we would see about almost a 20 cent rollback. And at the end of the day, after the Board of Equalization hearings, we're seeing about a 17 cent rollback in our proposed tax rate. For a number of years, Francis Howell had the highest tax rate in St. Charles County. Voters recently approved tax levy increases for the School District of the City of St. Charles, Fort Zumwalt School District, and the Wentzville School District. This, coupled with the loss of the special purpose levy in Francis Howell in 2014, makes our levy the next to lowest tax rate in St. Charles County for 2017. This chart graphically represents the district's tax rate over time. The increases in the rate from the period of 2009 to 2013 were caused by decreases in the assessed value. The higher tax rate was charged against a lower assessed value. Net revenue to the district, however, remained unchanged. This is the same information shown on the previous slide, but with the addition of red bars representing the voluntary rollbacks of the tax rate that were approved by the board in the years immediately following the last increase in our tax levy, which was in 2004. These rollbacks saved the taxpayers of Francis Howell School District over $30 million. Our revenue estimate of the proposed tax rates show that we will generate $121.6 million, and we budgeted just more than $122 million. So the tax rate is right in line with what we have proposed in our budget. Senate Bill 22 requires that we provide notice to the community of how much new revenue comes from new construction and how much from reassessment. As I indicated, we were allowed to collect 2.1% growth in our revenue this year, and that split almost equally between new construction and reassessment. Our total new construction values this year are $16,317,388. That's about $500,000 lower than last year and significantly lower than what we'd seen prior to the recession. So our new construction revenue will generate about $1.1 million and a very similar amount from reassessment. This is a chart showing our new construction over time. And again, if you look back to 2008, prior to the recession, our new construction number at that time was $46 million. So in the more recent years, we've had some dips and a little bit of growth, and it's been fairly consistent at around $16 or $17 million of new construction, but well below the levels that we saw previously. I want to talk a little bit about our tax rate relative to debt service. We've kept our debt service levy the same. We've used a model to help us generate what will be what will happen with our levy over time if our assessed value continues to grow. The model used in this chart shows growth of 3% in assessed values. Our proposed debt service levy for 2017-18 will not generate on a current basis sufficient revenue for the district's principal and interest payments, but we do have sufficient reserves in our debt service fund to make all of our necessary payments. If our AV continues to grow as projected, our debt service revenue, using the same levy amount, will generate sufficient revenue for our principal and interest payments on a current basis. Given the nature of how our debt is structured, the district does have the capacity today to issue additional bonds without increasing the debt service levy. It would just be a matter of how we structure the repayment of the principal and interest over time, some of that out further into the future. This chart shows overall ratios, overall values in St. Charles County. The red bars indicate the recessionary periods when values exceeded market value, calling for a reduction in our assessed value, which was an unusual event in St. Charles County. So the assessor's goal is always to try to bring rates as close to 100% of market value as possible. And you can see that as we get out to the far right side of that chart, that the bars are at about 95%, maybe dipping a little below that. And so that's why we got an average increase of about 7.7% in our assessed value. This slide demonstrates how our funding has changed over time. 10 years ago, in fiscal year 08, the state provided about 24% of the district's total operating revenue. Today, that amount is about 25%. So we have seen a slight increase in the percentage of revenue provided by the state. However, the overall burden is still carried by our local property owners, as you can see from the red segments of that pie chart. This is a graphic representation of our state aid by year, shown in total dollars. Our revenue last year exceeded the previous high point, which is shown by the red bar here. As we look at this year going forward, the state adequacy target has been increased for the 2017-18 year, and we do expect to see some additional state revenue as a result of that. That increase is offset to some degree by declines in other areas of state funding, such as transportation. Missouri does offer a property tax credit claim, and that gives credit for a portion of the real estate taxes or rent paid by certain senior citizens and individuals with 100% disability. The credit is for a maximum of $1,100 and can only be claimed on the home they actually occupied during the period being claimed. And the information about the property tax credit claim is available at the Department of Revenue website, and I've provided the web address there. And this document is available on Board Docs if people are interested in finding out more about that. So in summary, 2017 is a reassessment year. Our assessed values this year are $137.5 million higher than they were in 2009. Our new construction assessed value remains below our pre-recession levels, and our proposed tax rate for this year is $4.8527, which is almost 17 cents lower than last year. Mrs. Cope, that's my presentation. If there are questions from the board or anyone in the audience, I'd be happy to address those now.
Great, thank you, Mr. Supple. Do we have any questions regarding the tax rate hearing? Thank you, Mr. Supple.
Thank you.
So being 7 p.m., I will call the official Francis House School District Board meeting to order. We'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance, which is going to be led by the AP scholars from all four high schools.
You can do it from
here.
We have lost Mr. Clyde Mosier, who served on Mauser, thank you, who served on the Francis House School Board of Education from 1956 to 1973 as a member, a vice president, and president. Mr. Mauser supported renaming the district from the R3 School District to the Francis House School District of St. Charles County, Missouri, and made the motion for that change at the March 15, 1966 board meeting. He was the president of the board during the 1968-69 school year when the administration and board were developing a new year-round school calendar that was adopted for Becky David Elementary School that began July 1st, 1969. The four-cycle, nine-week, three-week calendar was the first used in the nation in modern times and benefited the Francis House School District for nearly 40 years. We've also lost Mr. Doug Patton, who was a cafeteria aide at Lardonwell, working for the district for a year and a half. During his time, he developed strong relationships with students, especially students with special needs who often sought him out. Just today, we lost Mr. Brian Fisher, who was a science teacher at Francis Howe Middle School, who worked for 14 years for the district. He was a caring, dedicated teacher who was a role model for students, including my own two sons. We lost Adam Strunk, a student attending Francis Howe North, who was a very special young man who was very energetic and loyal to his peers. He had an unbelievable spirit and a caring heart. In a final act of generosity and kindness, Adam's family donated several of his organs, and as a result, he has positively impacted at least six individuals across the country. And we lost Jaden Winger. She was a fourth grade student at Central Elementary School who loved school, playing soccer, pandas, and the color purple. She always loved attending school events. So please join with me in a moment of silence as we remember those who we have lost. Thank you. motion to approve the agenda as submitted? Motion made by Mrs. Walker, second by Mrs. Lang. By roll call?
Mrs. Walker?
Aye.
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 Motion carries 7-0. Recognitions, Mr. Dykman.
Thank you, Mrs. Cope. During the 2016-17 school year, Francis Howell Elementary and Middle Schools collected a record total $109,000 for the American Heart Association through Jump Rope for Heart, Hoops for Heart, and Dodge for Heart. Only four other school districts in Missouri raised more money for the American Heart Association last year. Donations benefit institutions such as St. Louis University and the Washington University School of Medicine and go directly towards research, treatment, and education. Fairmont Elementary raised a grand total of $16,349, the highest amount in the district, followed closely by Independence at $15,419 and Becky David at $14,502. In return, our schools earned vouchers for playground and PE equipment. Could I have those school representatives come up, please? Because of Fairmont's success, physical education teacher Kelly Gravlin was presented with the Mission Impact Award. This award recognizes volunteers and coordinators that have gone above and beyond in service of the American Heart Association's mission. Kelly was also recognized as the Rookie of the Year for the St. Louis-St. Charles metro area. Here with a few words is the American Heart Association Youth Marketing Director, Julie Hedeman.
Thank you so much. I want to echo the statements by Matt, and my name is Julie Hederman. I've been with the American Heart Association for over 10 years, and Barb Reiering works with your district. She had a previous commitment tonight, but she sends her congratulations and her sincere, you guys are awesome. Thank you so much. You have no idea the impact that you make, not just with the donations that you all have brought in, but just the amazing, and you guys hear the stories from these little guys. I mean, they will tell you now, Mom, don't drink soda, drink water. We're trying to get these healthier messages started earlier and earlier. So I did want to echo all of those congratulations, and I have a couple certificates here, but I definitely want to present Kelly. She took this on and traveled to multiple schools and still raised over $16,000.
Thank you all. Congratulations. Francis Howell was proud to announce that 242 students, the most in district history, were named Advanced Placement Scholars for 2016-17. The AP program recognizes high school students who have demonstrated outstanding college-level achievement through AP courses and exams with the prestigious AP Scholar Awards. While most of those AP scholars were seniors, 71 sophomores or juniors are enrolled in FHSD this year. The students who are recognized tonight all achieved the AP Scholar with Distinction Award, which means they received an average score of at least 3.5 on all AP exams taken and scores of 3 or higher on 5 or more of these exams. These students are, and if you would please come up as I call your name, Madeline Fields, Galen Evans, Brendan Heslin, Peter Liu, Aaron Zhang, Jennifer Ferry, David Hubbard, Alex Ron, Zach Miller, Ashley Rowland, and C.E. Wang. The National AP Scholar Award is granted to students who receive an average score of at least 4 on all AP exams taken and receive scores of 4 or higher on 8 or more of these exams. The prestigious National AP Scholar Award was presented to Michael Yu.
Picture, didn't come on up and get a picture. Don't be shy.
Thank you guys, congratulations. Here to introduce our student board rep, Francis Howell Central Principal Sunny Smiling Spartan Arnell.
I feel like I could do a flip or something with that introduction. Yeah, and you said, is it bad if the board is shorter than the students? I'm in trouble if that rule begins to apply. I've invested in some stilts. Again, my name is Sonny Arnell. I'm the principal of Francis Howell Central High School. It's my privilege to introduce our Board of Education student rep tonight, Mrs. Ashley Rowland. Please come on up. You know, I want to thank the board for recognizing the students that just had a moment to come up and stand in front of you all. Really, the business of our business is student achievement. Student growth, kind of just the learning process in general. And those kids tonight are doing it with such aplomb. It is amazing, amazing to me. I have a hard time sometimes picking out the right kind of cereal, and they're getting 4s and 5s on multiple AP tests. I mean, it's it is an amazing achievement. So thank you for doing that. It warms my heart. And Ms. Rowland is a prime example of one of those students. At Central, one of my biggest dreams, one of my favorite things about being a principal, is seeing our students come in as young Spartans and then attack their education, really make it their own, and then make Howell Central their home. Not just the classroom, but athletics and the halls and all the clubs and sports. And Ms. Rowland has done that. She's done a tremendous job of attacking the time at Howell Central and being the best she can be. Let me give you a few of her highlights just to kind of prove the point. When she does graduate, I hope I can hold her back for several years, but when she does graduate, she either wants to go to Vanderbilt or Rice University and be a biochemist. During the time, she's been heavily involved in our varsity girls basketball program, our varsity track program. She used to be a member of our softball team. She's part of our central outreach, our Erite Student Recognition Committee, our National Honor Society. Currently, she has a 4.76 GPA. That's crazy. That is amazing. She has won the Ultimate Spartan Award for the highest GPA on the girls' varsity track team. She's been a member, she's an officer for NHS, and she's, tonight you learned, she was an AP scholar. Last, in 2016, she was chosen to attend the Missouri Scholar Academy. She had a 33 on her ACT, and you could take, in 4 years, you could take 28 classes. She's taken, out of the 28 classes she could choose, 23 of them have been pre-AP or AP courses. That is amazing. So I'm just so proud of her and what she represents. Because you're getting the whole package. You're getting a student, an athlete, a scholar, and a humanitarian. She is gonna be someone's, a company or a neighborhood or some government official dream to have her on board. She's gonna do so many problem solvings for America. So I just can't wait to see what she does in her future. So with that, please give Ms. Rowland a big round of applause.
So welcome, and so excited to have you join us here at the dais. So we want you to participate in our conversation tonight. So if you have any questions, by all means ask. We would love to hear from you and your comments. You get to do whatever we do tonight except for vote. So thanks for joining us this evening. Not seeing patron comments this evening? FHEA? SAA? Okay. Board, I entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as submitted. Motion made by Mrs. Walker, seconded by Mr. Lane. By roll call. MSBA board report. Oh, best practice, did I miss a page? I apologize. Got stuck in my paper clip for the consent agenda. Next, we'll have our best practice, and we're going to turn that over to Mr. Butler.
Good evening, Board of Education, Executive Cabinet, Dr. Mary Hendricks-Harris. So tonight we're here to talk about best practices. And what we're going to talk about is all the great work we do for children with special needs. And I can figure no one to talk about that or help us understand that better than Kathy Fortin. So I'm going to hand it over to her.
Okay, so my name is Kathy Fortin. And I am, among other things, the ADA compliance officer for the Francis Scott School District. And I just want to thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to speak to you all tonight. As you can see, I'm here to share with you about how we are working to provide access for all. When we say provide access for all, we are talking about a commitment to making the Francis House School District accessible for everyone, including persons with a disability. Mostly, I'm so excited to get to recognize some of the people who make this possible. People who are near and dear to my heart because they are working constantly behind the scenes and are making a really big difference in the lives of many. So, why focus on accessibility? Well, there are many reasons that we must address accessibility in a school district. First, it's the law. So there are specific laws that govern our compliance to accessibility standards. One such law is the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is a civil rights law that prohibits discrimination against individuals with a disability in all areas of public life. This includes making all aspects of our district accessible, from facilities, to employment, to program access, to communication. All things have to be created with a mindset of accessibility. In addition, students in our districts also have specific rights under Section 504 and the IDEA that prohibits discrimination based upon disability and requires that the needs of students with disabilities are adequately met. So, when people ask me why we take on these projects, big projects, in the Francis House School District, such as placing curb cuts, or ensuring that our website is accessible, or making an entryway accessible, one answer is because we have to. But I'm here to talk today about the other reason, the real reason, and the reason that is worth recognizing and celebrating, the reason I'm here this evening. That is the heart. And by that, I mean the compassionate desire that I've seen in this Francis House School District to do the right thing. To be proactive and excited about supporting all of our students, all of our employees, parents, and patrons in a way that they can easily access our services and feel welcome on every campus. So, how do we determine our priorities? There are several things that are considered. First thing to share is that we conduct regular ADA accessibility surveys of each building in the district. Using the ADA accessibility guidelines, we identify areas that are not in compliance with ADA standards and then develop a transition plan with recommendations that are passed along to the ADA Advisory Committee and also to the Facilities Committee. However, when we have a student or employee or patron who has an immediate need, those items on the transition plan will be moved to high priority. So, while we attempt to be proactive in addressing accessibility through our transition plan, we have to be flexible in our plans to meet the dynamic needs of our Francis House community. So we mentioned that the real reason that we're here tonight is to celebrate really the heart behind it all. So one group who gets honorable mention in this regard are our folks in facilities. They truly get it, and they are always eager to jump into action when it means supporting our students, their families, and the Francis House community. So we'd like to recognize and show our gratitude to these wonderful men and women who have reached really superhero status, honestly, in our eyes. Amazing people who do what they do with a smile on their face and a warmth of heart that too often goes unnoticed. So do we want to introduce just a few?
Yes, I will. They're here in the audience today. I'm going to make them stand up just to embarrass them. So we have Mike Dieters. Mike will stand up. He is our grounds manager. We have Jason Griesenauer, who's our safety manager. And then last, we have Dennis Nasovich, who is our custodial manager and helps with our office.
Highlight who they are and the importance of their work through some projects and some cute kids. some projects that were completed this summer. All right, so seriously, how cute. So the first thing we want to talk about is maintaining the equipment and keeping things clean. First, we want to recognize our maintenance crew who maintain the buildings and equipment and the custodians who keep things clean and in order. Every summer and throughout the year, we witness custodians using the first clean bucket to mop our mats and clean those surfaces that kids are using. Doing this ensures that our kids stay healthy so that they can maintain good attendance and learn. And during the summer, our maintenance folks do equipment checks like the swings that you saw to ensure that students are safe, and they complete all necessary building modifications, even things like being sure the doors open easily enough, so that staff and patrons and students can navigate independently through buildings. This next slide talks about customizing equipment that fits just right. So over the summer and throughout the school year, we have incredibly talented folks who are able to construct custom furniture and modifications to allow students to access all aspects of their learning environment and other essential areas. Like you can see, there's a toilet there and a sink. So we make sure they can access those areas. This is necessary when students move to a different building or even just move to a different area in the same building. This often involves our facility staff meeting with other staff, student, and parents to ensure that what is created is just right. Again, all this is done with a smile on their face and a warmth of heart. Okay, this next slide is about getting equipment to the right place. As you can see, this young man is using a head mouse, which is some pretty cool technology, to be able to type on a computer, but he really couldn't do that unless he had the appropriate work surface. So every summer and throughout the year, our district movers get large pieces of equipment to our student summer programming and then back to their home schools, or they move equipment to a new school when a student transitions to a different level. So parents can have a peace of mind that anything their child will need for success at school will be there on day one. Again, always with a no problem kind of attitude. Sometimes we even are like, it's got to get there tomorrow, and they're like, no problem, we got this. So the next slide is ensuring student safety and access. Some bigger projects that were tackled this summer included installation of some curb cuts with truncated domes to ensure safe travel of students. An accessible ramp was also installed at Becky David to allow individuals who use a wheelchair or walker to access the main entrance of the building. All of these projects require a lot of planning and overseeing that is all done by our wonderful facilities teams. This slide is called Helping Kids Be Independent, and I just can't help but smile when I look at this. This slide in this video shows students who are able to access automatic towels, faucets, and soap dispensers, some of which were installed just this past summer. The counter pictured on the right was also modified so that all the students could access the sink. Because of these modifications, students can be independent throughout their day. The smiles that you see were all made possible by your Francis Howell Facilities team. And this is truly just the very tip of the iceberg. There were many, many, many other projects, just too many to go into right now. And there are so many other ways that our facilities works toward improving access each and every day. So for all you do, we are truly appreciative.
Thank you. For making our truncated dome, and thank you for doing all the things they have done for us. Yay! Bye-bye!
She's like that every day. It's wonderful. So please join me and these wonderful kids in saying thank you to our wonderful facilities team for a job well done, but mostly for doing what they do with kindness, compassion, and the right heart. Thank you.
We would be remiss if we didn't also thank Ms. Fortney for all of her work throughout the district. She is an advocate for our students. She is a proactive member of our leadership team, always looking out for the needs of the special needs students that you saw in the video today. So she, in addition to our facilities department, helps lead out that work.
So, excellent presentation. Thank you very much for the information, and a wonderful job done by all helping some of those great special kids in our district, and patrons and families as well. So thank you.
Okay, on our agenda next, I believe now we have the MSBA board report.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Missouri School Boards Association's board report for the month of September. We thank you for the opportunity to share some news and information during a few minutes of your board meeting. We begin with a look at the makeup of the State Board of Education. Governor Greitens is putting his mark on the State Board of Education through some appointments to the 8-member board. In August, the governor appointed Melissa Gellner of Springfield and Eddie Justice of Poplar Bluff to the state board. They were sworn in during the board's August meeting. However, the governor later withdrew Gellner's appointment. Gellner then issued a statement in which she said she was frustrated by the governor's policy team and the little effort from them to collaborate with the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education to work on behalf of our public schools. She added, "I'm also concerned about the pressure I've recently experienced to make rash decisions." Two additional members were appointed by the governor in late August and were sworn in at the September meeting. The new state board members can begin their service immediately, but are subject to confirmation by the Missouri Senate. They serve staggered 8-year terms. No more than 4 members can belong to the same political party, and no more than 1 member can be from the same county or congressional district. The state board has considerable influence over education policy on the state level and appoints the Commissioner of Education. MSBA officers and staff attend the monthly meetings of the state board. During its August meeting, the state board approved Missouri's plan under the federal government's Every Student Succeeds Act. Each state must submit a plan under the federal law. The Department of Elementary and Secondary Education has worked on the plan for a year and held 9 regional meetings to hear from the public on what matters most in the education of children. In a presentation to the state board, Assistant Commissioner Dr. Chris Neal characterized the document as a skinny plan that satisfies federal requirements but doesn't go beyond that. Neal says the Missouri School Improvement Plan will continue to be the primary driver of school improvement for schools throughout the state.
Missouri believes that the Missouri School Improvement Plan is a primary improvement driver. We continue to believe that is the proper way to affect systemic improvement to all districts and charter LEAs, but ESSA is an important, fairly narrow, but important a part of our approach to improving schools, primarily through that statewide system of support for school improvement, through the aspects of improving and supporting our educators and our educational leaders, and finally in Title IV specifically to increase equitable access to high quality education.
The State Board of Education will consider adopting the latest version of the Missouri School Improvement Plan for public comment at its October meeting. The MSBA Delegate Assembly will be considering an important document of its own at a meeting on October 6th at the Lake of the Ozarks. The Delegate Assembly will be considering MSBA's proposed advocacy positions document that combines 3 previous documents, legislative resolutions, MSBA's platform statements, and position statements contained in the Missouri Public Education Vision Project report. The Advocacy Committee and Executive Committee have spent the past year working on combining those documents.
The purpose of doing this, having a new document, is for us to have one concise document that we, as an organization, have our stance on all legislative issues affecting public education, for us as board members, and more importantly, for our MSBA staff to help in advocacy efforts as we work with our legislators throughout the year, but most especially through the legislative session.
Meese adds the new advocacy positions document will make MSBA and local board members even more effective advocates for public education.
And I know that as a local board member and all of us as local board members try to be as nonpartisan as we can when it comes to issues, because we have to do what's best for kids, and it could be on either side of the aisle, but our focus is on our children, our students, and their success in schools. And these are positions that we feel are extremely important to help our students succeed in their schools and then in their lives.
Every MSBA member school board is entitled to send at least 1 voting delegate to the Delegate Assembly that will be held in conjunction with the 2017 MSBA Annual Conference. Be sure your school board is represented at the Delegate Assembly. There is still time to register for the annual conference that will be held October 5th through 8th at the Lake of the Ozarks. The event features outstanding keynote speakers and 130 breakout sessions on a wide range of topics of interest to school board members and administrators. The annual MSBA School Personnel Information Survey is now open. This survey collects information on the wages, salaries, and benefits of teachers and other school employees to help boards and administrators make fully informed personnel decisions. Member districts that complete the survey and submit their salary schedules and collective bargaining agreements by November 13th receive free access to the data collected. Make sure your district's information is included in this year's database. That's it for this month's edition of the MSBA Board Report. Thanks for allowing us to have some time at your board meeting, and so long from Columbia.
Thank you. Next on our agenda is the section on fiscal responsibility. Board, I'll entertain a motion to approve the August 2017 financial statements as presented. Motion made by Mrs. Walker, seconded by Mrs. Ferguson. Discussion? By roll call.
Ms. Ferguson?
Aye.
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 Motion carries 7-0. Board, I entertain a motion to approve the purchases over $7,500 as presented.
So moved.
Motion made by Mrs. Ferguson, seconded by Mrs. Walker. Discussion? By roll call.
Mr. Lang?
Aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries 7-0. Next on our agenda is the 2017-18 tax rate approval. Bear with me while I read the motion. Board, I'll entertain a motion to set the 2017 tax rate by fund as follows. Incidental fund, $2.10.69. Teachers fund, $2.01.45. Debt service fund, $0.67.13. Capital projects fund, $0.06. For a total levy of $4.85.27.
So moved.
Motion made by Mrs. Walker, seconded by Mrs. Ferguson. Discussion? You want to amend that? By roll call.
Mr. Hain?
Aye.
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 Motion carries 7-0. Next on the agenda is the vending revenue budget for FY 2018. Board, I'll entertain a motion to approve the vending revenue budget for 18 as presented. Motion made by Mr. Hain and seconded by Mrs. Lang. Mr. Supple?
Thank you, Mrs. Cope. I just wanted to provide a couple of items of clarification. It was noted in the memo, but I think it's worth discussing. We had previously provided a larger dollar allocation within this revenue vending revenue budget for student competitions, but we've been very successful at our high schools in involving our kids in great activities, and we found that it was better for us to move some of that to our operating budget. So for last year and then this year and as we move forward, we do have an allocation in our operating budget to help support students attending our national competitions. So we're very proud of the work that our kids do. We want to support them when they're able to qualify for those great events. But that is a reduction that we have made in our vending revenue budget because the level of support we would need from the vending revenue would make it impossible for us to sustain it over time. Also, we think it's part of our core work with our kids and probably should best be supported by our operating budget anyway. The other piece is that we have traditionally provided some funding to the high schools to support their after graduation parties to help kids keep our kids safe and to celebrate a great high school career. And again, that money is included this year. If there's any discussion about wanting to make changes to that as we move forward, this would be a good time for us to talk about that so that those, that they're not the class of 18, but the class of 19 and beyond could begin to make plans for what may or may not be available for them in the future. But it's the same level of funding that we have provided previously.
Any comments, discussion, questions?
On the funding that we give to each of the schools, and we've done that for a while, how did we come to that amount?
We take a look at the FTE assigned to each school, the teacher and non-teacher staff assigned to each school, and we divide it that way. So they get proportionally the same amount of money based on their staff population.
So a question that I have, we've re-looked at, because of the number of students attending the higher level of achievement opportunities, how is the other budget line items doing? Are they meeting their needs?
Last year was our first year to implement that, and so we were we didn't budget as much money as we needed, but we've made adjustments for fiscal year 18. And it would tend to fluctuate a little bit each year, so we based our budget last year on historical participation rates, and last year we had a higher level of participation for, and that can vary for any number of reasons. As high school principals have shared with me, sometimes the national competition might conflict with prom, and students are torn between which event to attend, which could have an impact on the number of people who choose to go. But we are in continuing conversations with our high school principals to refine that so that we can make, the bottom line is we made sure that every child who qualified and who desired to was able to attend the national competition.
And thank you, Mr. Supple. I actually was more referring to the other line items. So the staff recognition, line item, and I think there's another line item that you mentioned, the high school parties. Are we feeling that what we have budgeted for this next year and the future, is it a relevantly correct amount?
For the staff recognitions, yes. It's difficult, you know, it doesn't give them any school a lot of money. They can probably have an event either at the beginning or the end of the year to even celebrate the start of a new school year, the conclusion of a successful one. But it is a way for us to recognize that it's important to celebrate our staff and the great work that they do. In terms of the support for our high school graduation parties, that would probably be a little bit subject for debate. You've had an opportunity to attend it, and you know that we do some great things for our kids, and maybe that's probably that's a decision for the parents, but we probably are, I would say we're there at the board through this revenue budget. It's very generous to our high schools and helping to support them in those activities.
Okay, thank you. Board, any other questions? Okay. By roll call.
Ms. Lane?
Aye.
Motion carries 7-0. Thank you, Mr. Sutton.
You're welcome.
Next on the agenda is the fleet copier replacement. Board, I'll entertain a motion to approve the purchase of fleet copiers from Macro Technologies, including the value added proposal to replace the print shop copiers and to approve financing for the fleet copiers through Commerce Bank. Motion made by Mr. Lane, seconded by Mrs. Walker. Mr. Supple.
Thank you, Mrs. Cope. I just wanted to provide one clarification. When we sought financing from Commerce Bank, we wanted to make sure that we were providing the board with the most accurate information. So we did ask them to update their proposal to us, and so the date that's reflected on both the cover letter and then the actual amortization page are just placeholder dates. We don't have any copiers, we don't have any equipment in place, so no documents have been signed relative to securing that funding, but this is a proposal that will go into place if the purchase is approved. Before they would give us the money, we'd actually have to have the equipment that we're buying. So it might have been a little confusing that the date seemed to precede the board meeting, but it's not an effective date of that financing. That financing won't be effective until we actually take possession of the copiers.
Thank you. Board, any questions? Discussion? Ashley, got a question on the copiers? You're okay? All right. By roll call.
Ms. Walker.
Aye.
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 Motion carries 7-0. Board, next on our agenda is the first reading of several policies, so please make sure that you've taken a look at those. Following that, we have an update on our strategic planning committee. So each of our board members attend one of our current strategic planning committees, and we're adding in this year that the board members are going to report out on the status of how those teams are doing and some of the high priorities. And so first on the list, Academic Strategic Planning Committee, ASPC.
That would be me. I've been on the Academic Strategic Planning Committee for, this is my third year, and we had our first meeting of the year a couple weeks ago.
Sure.
Sam and I were both there. It was extremely well attended. I was glad to see a lot of parents and community members at that meeting itself. Nicole gave us information on the preliminary data presentation, the data of the district, and she reviewed the CSIP goals with the team there. For the board itself, we have foundations of the AP classes and honors physical science curricula that we reviewed. The one I really want to highlight is the foundations of AP. It's a new class to encourage students to take an AP class. Not students like yourself, but students more like me. I had A's and B's, Michelle, but it encourages me to take these classes, and it gives that foundation that's built around that. And so I highly suggest the board and the audience itself review that curricula and see what they feel about it. But the meeting went well, and as I said, it was very well attended.
Great. Glad to hear that. Community relations,
that would be me, and this is my first time being on the Community Relations Committee. I was there along with Michelle. We had our first meeting earlier this month. And what we did at the meeting was we watched the data presentation that the district will be showing at the strategic planning meetings. We were able to give our feedback, both positive and negative. Sorry, Matt. And they were
sorry.
They went back and made some changes regarding graphics, text, and wording on some slides based on our committee's recommendations. In our next meeting, we will be attending one of the strategic planning engagement meetings, which are September 28th, October 3rd, and 4th.
For the record, we were excited to have the opportunity to use the Community Relations Committee as a focus group. They provided invaluable feedback that we incorporated into the presentation, and you'll see it at those community engagement meetings.
Which are September 28th, October 3rd, and 4th.
And we especially appreciate Ms. Lang's plug for those meetings.
Which are the 28th, 3rd,
and 4th. And where are they?
Each of our high schools. Francis Howell High School is the 28th, and then Francis Howell North is October 3rd, and Francis Howell Central is October 4th.
And that was it. It was great. It was a good meeting.
Good.
Very well attended. Great communication.
Good. Glad to hear that. Finance and operations, Mrs. Ferguson.
It's broken.
Okay, attending the meeting
for the first time, just getting all the background and all the information that was out there was just an eye-opening input overload at different parts, but very well done, very just broken out into sections where you really knew what was going on. I think what I enjoyed the most was the committee that was looking outside the box for revenues in that, and that really intrigued me the most, and the conversation that went along that on how to secure some other funding for our district through different means. So it's like taking a group of people and saying, let's look outside this box that's normal. Let's not just tap into this person and this person. Let's tap into the community, into the state, into the, you know, all around us, and really look for some hard money that's out there. It just is going to take time. And how they you know, broke everything down, it was very interesting to see. They're further than I thought they would be, and it was an eye-opener, and I was really excited about that.
Thank you very much. So at our next meeting, we'll hear a report on the remaining committees. So next on our agenda is our work session. So we are going to move down to the tables. We are going to have a report, actually, from the Non-Tax Revenue Task Force Facility Utilization Business Plan. So board, if you'll join me down at the tables. There's been a request for a 5-minute break, and we will reconvene at the tables.
I just made it.
They can't make any decisions during a work session. Usually there'll be something that they'll move forward for to a formal meeting to make a decision. Our chance to have a conversation.
And why did they have to
that would be a good board meeting, so it's sort of called Robert's Rules of Interpretation.
Jack Heaton is here this evening as a community member and a member of the Finance and Operations Committee. Anita Keener, Renee Schuster, Cliff Stevie, and then I serve on that as well. We've really done some great thinking, and to Mrs. Ferguson's point earlier, trying to think differently about the work, not approach it from the same perspective. So having the experience of different individuals and their voices in the room has been great. Both Jack and Cliff have brought some unique and interesting perspectives and ways to approach the work, and it's been good to have those very stimulating conversations. So we began by determining an objective, and it's a pretty aggressive objective. But we want to try to focus on creating a continuing revenue stream that would be equal to somewhere in the range of 2 to 3% of our operating budget, or maybe $3 to $5 million a year. And we would do that by really focusing on some of the district's core competencies. What are the things that we're already doing that we can leverage and find a way to generate revenue as a result of that? That might be some of the great curriculum work that we do and finding a way to market that. It could be taking advantage of excess capacity, and we'll talk a little bit about that tonight, but there's a good definition around that. And certainly charging for some of the optional programs. So we will also want to include in that taking a look at ways to encourage people to contribute in a formalized way to the school district through some tax-favored entities that will provide some advantage to the donor as well as to us as a recipient. So again, just to take a look. So some of the ways, you know, promoting and selling our assets. So what would that really mean? Well, we developed some great curriculum materials, and not every school district has the level of expertise available. So maybe there's some smaller rural school districts that would be interested in following our path and purchasing our curriculum from us. We've had some inquiries. I've had a brief conversation with Dr. Greiner. The school district has already expressed some interest, and so maybe we can find a way to formalize that process. We do a great job with our summer school programs, and we have had to expand the capacity year over year over year as interest in those programs has grown. But maybe there's an opportunity to think differently and greatly expand and attract individuals outside of the Francis Howell School District to come and pay tuition, or to allow us to collect the ABA on those students as a way to generate some additional revenue. The course renting facilities, which we'll have a more in-depth conversation about in a little bit, and a different way of approaching our curriculum would be to develop some virtual education programs or distance learning so that people could access our curriculum. We wouldn't necessarily sell it to them, but instead of buying a curriculum from a national corporation that their students could use, they would we would have a virtual program of distance learning that they could access on our curriculum. Other ideas would be filling our excess capacity, so promoting students outside of the Francis Howell School District to take advantage of our educational programs. And that might mean that we would think differently about the types of programs that we offer. We could also find a way to generate funds by encouraging enrollment in our district, and that might be supported by pre-tax dollars through some of the programs already available, or if at any point in the future the state of Missouri has some type of a tax credit program, that we would have an opportunity to leverage that and take advantage of that. So some of the examples of expanding our offerings would be a school within a school. So maybe we would create our own charter school. We can also think about a grade 13 for kids who want to transition to college, or maybe offer technical certifications that would be for kids who are not college bound. We have a great before and after school care program, but there may be opportunities to leverage that and expand it by taking a look at infant daycare and maybe expanding some of our pre-kindergarten programs. So just a thought process as we move forward that these are some ideas that could be beneficial. There's also opportunities to charge for some of the activities that we already have. And of course, as we had this conversation, the brainstorming of the extracurricular task force had not yet completed its work, but the board recently approved an activity fee for our students. And so some of that is already underway, but there may be some other things that we could explore in terms of payment for services that are already provided. And then also the important part is soliciting donations and endowments. We've had a number of people indicate in our conversations at the Finance Committee that it would be great if there was a way to easily donate to the district. We quickly acted on that, and there is a link on the website if you want to make a donation. There's a quick link for you to do that. And so we're glad to have that. But there are some formalized things we can do too. The Alumni Foundation is the reconstituted Howell Foundation, and we'd really like to begin to get a very active board who could move that forward and begin to develop some of those signature activities that become a fundraising magnet within the community. And people know that every year the Francis Howell Alumni Association is going to host a golf tournament, a trivia night, whatever it might be, and it becomes an event that everybody looks forward to doing. Adopt a child, so much as you've seen some of the promotions on TV, you know, we might be able to say, you know, for $5 a day, we can help our kids move towards a one-to-one initiative or something like that. We could leverage to a greater degree sponsorship opportunities. We do have to kind of a passive approach to that. We could become more aggressive. We've had some conversation with the activity directors over the years about doing so. One of the drawbacks is, of course, the amount of personnel time that's required for something like that to work. We have talked to outside organizations that do that work, but they've shared with us that the sponsors really want to have the direct contact with the school district. So while it's great that this third-party company is making the connections, they want to talk to the person at the school. So it is a big time commitment. And our activity directors felt that they really needed to focus on the work that they're doing, which is supporting our kids in the various activities, and that this would be difficult. But we might be able to look at a different way of providing the personnel support to do that. And then finally, much like our colleges and universities, or those who may have attended a private secondary school, they're very good at fundraising. They keep their alumni lists, they send you information regularly, whether you give money to them or not, and they keep reminding you about what you need to do and how you can include them in your will or find other ways to reduce your tax liability and still do something great for an organization. We as a public school district haven't been aggressive in doing that, but maybe there's an opportunity for us to learn more about that and really target people who are looking to find a way to reduce their tax liability and want to do something positive to support the community as they do so. So as we talked about those examples, and again, those are some samples of what we talked about, we really thought that there's some critical questions that we need to ask as we went through this work. So do we have talent internally? Are there some people who have the knowledge and expertise? So just thinking back to the last item, I will tell you that I know a lot about a lot of things, but I would not be the one to advise you on how to best reduce your taxable income. That's a whole other set of skills, so you might have to think differently about having to get that talent inside. What resources do we need? What impediments might there be, and how can we minimize those? So as we thought about how do we move this project forward, those were some of our guiding questions. So our ultimate goal was to begin to implement some of the ideas that we talked about. We knew a couple things. Our initial funding was going to be very limited, so we had to find a way to cover that within our existing budget, and that any benefit had to be a positive to the bottom line. We knew that we had to work within our existing organizational structure as much as possible, and that there would need to be probably some specific FTE dedicated to this work in order to move it forward, that it's important enough that it can't be a sliver of somebody else's job. It would need to be someone who has a real focus on that. We would look for the criteria for success as we move forward, and that members of the team would be able to lend some of their expertise in order to serve as a mentor. And so the idea of all of those guiding questions and those ideas are what brought us to where we are. So as we thought about the work, we knew that we needed to prioritize what we were going to attack first. So these are the criteria that we used. How how much revenue can we generate? So we might have a great idea, but if it only generates $1,000 a year, we probably don't need to focus on it. How easy is it to implement? So again, we might have a great idea and it'll generate $1 million a year, but it's a long-term thing. So getting that signature event is not going to happen in 1 year. You have to build capacity for that. So ease of implementation is a consideration. How quickly are we going to see the return? So having a program for people to make tax deductible contributions or to remember us in their wills will be a great thing for us to do, but some of that payoff might be years in the future. What is the size? What's the size of the investment that's required to get this to move forward? So again, might be a great idea, but it's very costly to implement. And finally, what available talent do we have to implement that? So based on that, we decided that these criteria lend themselves best to an exploration of our facility rentals and how could we do that. We think we could probably generate some revenue that's meaningful. It's going to be fairly easy for us to implement. The speed of return is going to be very quick. It doesn't require a huge investment, although there will be some. And we think we have some talent and resources within the organization to move forward. So that's how we got to where we are. I specifically chose the language because I do think that this is important to place a proper framework around the work that we're doing. So this is facility utilization business plan. And it is a change in our mindset, and I want to be very clear about that right from the beginning. The current approach to our facilities is that we have some capacity, we have a very supportive community. Through their taxes, they have helped to pay the bonds that build these buildings, and we have made them accessible to our community, oftentimes at no cost. This is a rethinking of that we are now taking a look at our facilities as an asset that we can leverage, and we're going to approach it like a business, and our goal is to make money. So previous mindset was providing access, our new mindset, if it's approved by the board, would be to really focus on this as a business and a way to generate revenue. And so we involved a lot of voices in that conversation. As you take a look at the list here, you can see we had activity director of facilities, we had a number of parents, we had very important voices in the room, which were our activity secretaries, who do a lot of the scheduling of our facilities currently, representative of our custodial staff, because they're going to be responsible for cleaning up after that. And so we tried to really get a diverse set of voices to help us examine what we're talking about. And our objective was to find a way to take what we already have, generate revenue for the district. And so our excess capacity was really very broadly defined. It's certainly our gyms and our performance fields, but also our classrooms. There may be some opportunities to rent out even just a classroom at a time or a small auditorium. Our goal would be to generate $200,000 in the first year. That revenue, less any expenses that would be necessary to implement this program, would of course then just accrue to the general fund. We do think that if it's managed aggressively, we have an opportunity that this could potentially be $1 million a year in revenue. Our current situation is that we only generate about $15,000 of revenue a year. And that's because almost all of the groups who use our facilities don't pay us anything. And the ones that do pay us something, they don't use it intensively enough to really generate a lot of money. So we've also found that the management is very manual. So the process really is, if I'm interested in using the gym at Sager, I contact Sager Middle School. And someone at Sager Middle School has to try to figure out whether or not that space is available. And there is some, the principals necessarily want to have control of their own buildings. And so I think there have been times when groups have been told no, when the building could have been available, but it was not something that the principal wanted to take on because they only have to have somebody here that night. We're already busy with some other things. It became, one more thing to do. So I think that manual approach to securing the site, and that there's no common policy about who does and does not, and whether we say yes or no, I think some of that really needed to be tightened up. And as I said, many of the groups who are somewhat loosely affiliated with the school district are using our facilities and really not paying us anything to do so. So as we took a look, we know that we have our elementary schools, and we have a gymnasium at each of those schools. Henderson actually has two practice gyms. And we knew that if you take a look at capacity, they could be rented every weeknight from 5 to 9 p.m. and on Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. So that's how we defined what our utilization capacity was. And that the fee was currently $15 an hour. So if you just take a look at elementary schools, you can see the math there. There's a total of 1,400 hours available per month. If we filled it at 100% capacity, we could generate about $20,000 a month. Now, we're realistic enough to realize that you aren't going to have 100% capacity, especially not in the first year. So just as a placeholder, a way to begin the conversation, we thought, well, we could probably do a third of that. So we took a look at 35% capacity. We would generate about $7,400 a month by renting our gyms out for 492 hours at $15 an hour. So that's a way for us to begin that conversation. Then we took a look at, so what are the costs associated with that? Well, we'd have some custodial services, so that'd be about $1,800 a month, and we could have at 100% capacity, and $3,000 a month at 35% capacity. And we would try to leverage that as best we could, taking advantage of existing staff, but also being mindful that our existing staff have to get our buildings ready for kids the next day, and so we don't want to dilute the force too much. We may need to have some additional custodial capacity directed specifically towards taking care of the rentals and cleaning up after that. So similarly, we approached the middle school, five gyms, same types of hours available. Middle school gyms, because they're a little bit larger and more standard in size, would rent for $40 an hour instead of 15. And so the potential revenue, the same type of calculation, about $30,000 a month at 100% capacity, but $10,000 a month, a little over that, at 35% capacity. And then our potential custodial cost at 100% capacity would be about $4,600 a month, or about $1,600 at the 35% capacity. So those were the ideas that we looked at as we were moving forward. And from all of that conversation, we generated some recommendations. So the first thing that we feel very strongly about is that we need to, if we're going to be serious about this, if we're going to approach it like a business, if our goal is to raise revenue and to leverage the capacity that we think is available there, we need to have someone whose sole focus, or almost entire focus, is on facility rental. So our first recommendation is to hire, create a new staff position to oversee the scheduling of our buildings and to perform other tasks related to building usage. So somebody needs to go and talk with the groups that are using the facilities to make sure they understand our rules and regulations. Somebody needs to be that ombudsman to settle disputes when something was damaged and the group says they didn't do it, the school says yes they did. Who's going to be kind of settling those conversations? We also think that almost as critical, if not more critical, is to get an electronic scheduling software. We need to make it easy for people to go online and see all of the capacity available. So if I go to say and they tell me no, I have to think to myself, well, where else can I go? I could maybe go to Bride. You need to make it so you can go online, see exactly what is available. And more critical than anything else, since you can pay and are required to pay up front. That's been one of our problems too, is that people make a rental and then we try to collect after they've used the facility, which is sometimes very difficult to do. And so scheduling software, I think, really critical to the success of this, and the cost for that would be about $10,000. And then finally, and also very critical, would be, again, a change in our mindset. So we had a lot of conversation about this and arrived at the conclusion that the way that this is going to work is only if we adopt the mindset that we will charge all outside groups the full rate to use our facilities, including those that have some affiliation with the school district. And the exception would be only groups that are under the direct supervision of a district staff member who's receiving a stipend to supervise that activity. So if I'm the cheer coach, my cheer team can practice in our gym. But if I have a junior cheer team and I'm the cheer coach for the varsity, the junior cheer team has to pay to use a facility, because we're not paying the cheerleader to do the junior squad. We're paying them for the varsity. The varsity gets to use it, that's our team. The juniors, the up and coming, the middle school kids who want to be at high school and be on the cheer team, they have to pay to use it. And there would probably be other, you know, you can take any sport, but any of the theater teams are what we're talking about. And of course, we would start with the gymnasiums, but we think there's a great opportunity to better leverage our fields. We have a lot of groups using our fields. We know there's some potential expense around that. Certainly the first thing would be signage, that much like you would go to any one of our county parks. You know, they have a little thing posted to who has it rented when. And again, that staff position would be there to settle those disputes, like, I reserved this field from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. today, and somebody else is on the field. That's the person that had to answer that question to deal with those issues. So that's my presentation. Again, a huge thanks to that core team who helped get these ideas moving forward and create the template that we use to guide our decision making, and then to that subset who worked specifically on facility rental and the hours of the conversation about moving this forward. And this is not the last you'll hear from the non-tax revenue task force. This is just the first idea that we were able to operationalize because it was easy to implement and there was a speedy return. We had some in-house capacity that we thought we could leverage to do that. So I'd be happy to answer questions. Mary?
Where did you guys come up with the $40 an hour for the gym?
I think posted with the business plan is a breakdown of we did a survey of surrounding school districts, so we have an idea of what other districts are charging.
We're really involved in club soccer, and I will tell you, we pay a lot more an hour at Lutheran and Christian.
And I think that's something that.
So,
That you know, once we, and again, our approach has been so passive up to this point that it hasn't been a focal area.
No,
and
my point would be too,
I think that would be part of
our entire soccer club would flock to Francis Hall School
District. And I think we have to make sure that we're charging market rates.
Yes.
So we have to do a much more in depth. You know, we may have looked at what other school districts are charging, but again, their approach is probably very different than maybe the city of St. Peter's or.
We're Rush Soccer Club, but we practice at Lutheran, and we practice at Christian, and we practice at McFord.
So we'd have to. Yeah, I think we'd have to do a study to really find out what the going rate was, so that we could charge the appropriate rate. We don't want.
I mean, I've already scheduled all of our practices.
We don't want to undercut. We don't want to undercut the market.
At this rate. But I think that's a great.
I have a couple questions. One, have you thought about liability? What is our liability? Is it different than it is today, or is it the same?
Well, we would require the groups to provide a certificate of insurance for us and name us as an additional insured. So most of the organized teams already have that. Mrs. Ferguson in our Finance and Operations Committee shared that the scouts are required to carry $2 million of liability insurance. It's as putting together their troop, they're required to do that. I think the Boy Scout National Organization helps them with that. So I think most of these groups already have insurance, but that would again be part of the function of that staff person, would be to ensure that groups are providing us with evidence of insurability, because we would need that protection.
Has the team thought about a lot
allowable time. So you mentioned the cheer as the example tonight. And so as a church coach, we're practicing every day from 3 to 4. Now I understand that you're going to run out the gym, so I really want 3 to 5. I mean, just has the committee thought about our current users that for district purposes, expanding what they want to hold on to ensure that they get what they need?
Well, I think that the first answer to that would be that we work within our organization currently and ensure that any of our groups that we would not charge, so any group that's under the direction of a paid sponsor, would have priority in terms of using our facilities. Given that, we would want to have conversations to make sure that they're being realistic. You know, you aren't going to suddenly need an additional hour every day if you're doing it only to pad yourself. I think we'd have to take a look at that, because again, we're approaching this as a business, and you want to be conserve your asset, and your asset is time in this regard, and so you want to be careful about conserving that.
And we need to think less about the high schools and more about the elementary and middle schools. So our high school gyms are frequently used, and you saw in the presentation that we were focusing on elementary and middle schools whose utilization is very low.
Okay. And do you envision that school also plug into the tool that we would purchase for scheduling parents as teachers night because it's in the gym or?
Yes. Yes, it would be comprehensive schedule, which would really give us a picture of availability.
Sure.
Because if we don't take into account those big events, it would be problematic. And I think much of that is already available. It's just all done manually.
Sure.
Central Elementary knows theirs, and Central High School knows theirs, but Central High School doesn't know Central Elementary and vice versa. This way everybody would be able to see everything.
Thank you. And there's some challenges with consistency there, so who signs up for the gym and user friendliness. Very difficult, as Kevin said, you have to go down the line. It's difficult for larger organizations to sign up across the board in multiple buildings because of all of the individual calls that need to be made. It is very
difficult. I've just done some checking and talking to different ones, and I have found out that there was one particular scout group that was being charged. And then they got a new principal and then wasn't being charged anymore. So they had no problem with, we need to be charged. And then one group said, well, we use the gymnasium. One group said, no, we use the cafeteria. So would that be less? And, just kind of getting, what would that cost? And I said, well, what are you paying now? Type thing. And it was all positive. They couldn't believe that they were using the facilities without having to put in a lot of money, because it encompasses not only our students, but other students also. It's not just our students, so very receptive, and that it would work just fine. They would like a tool so they could go,
sure.
Because they have committee meetings and different meetings, and they don't mind, but that way they'd have a tool to be able to get what they want.
I think that speaks to that consistency piece. So once we had the tool, we would be able to be more consistent across the board.
Mm-hmm.
Patrick,
I need the mic. A couple of things I noted. The elementary school's 5 to 9. Vacation Station uses the gyms quite a bit, so you may have to move that from 6 to 9 in some places. And then I also feel like another opportunity we have is the Heritage Building and the 3 early childhood centers. They're used by the scouts now. They're a great room. And it's usually though after 6 o'clock, because we do 4 and a half school care. You need to ask them. Those principals are in charge of that.
Sure.
But those are 4 other facilities. It's not a gym,
yeah.
But it's a nice sized room that someone can utilize in the evening.
And again, I do think that, just want to be clear that the board understands, what we tried to do was provide some documentation that there is a reason to move forward with this plan.
Right.
That if we were to do this and this, we think we can generate this much. That makes sense. If we get permission to move forward, one of the first jobs of that new staff person will be to do exactly what Patrick and others have suggested, which is A, find out who's using what, when, why, and how. B, because I don't think we have a comprehensive knowledge of that, right? Every building is making individual decisions. And we're going to have to do a study of how much are people paying elsewhere to use these facilities so that we can get the right rates and levels. So it's not going to happen immediately, but the information presented was not, this is all we're going to do to start. It was more, if we only did this, we think we could make some money, and it would be worthwhile moving forward.
So the board asked us to study some options, and this was one of the options that we studied. I know that Sandy has said that, just running it by some of her friends and scouts, that they were amenable to the idea. You don't want the board to go into this thinking that this is going to go smoothly with all those organizations that we are not charging. And so you can anticipate that you will be getting some calls, you will be getting some pushback, and that is part of what you need to balance when you're making this decision about is now the right time and is to pursue this.
I guess the issue that I have with it is we're in the business to educate kids. We're not in the business to rent rooms and do all this other stuff. We get a lot of goodwill by providing these rooms, providing these things for other organizations that in turn provide additional services and benefits to us. Indirectly or directly. I mean, by having people in our buildings, they're more secure and everything else. There's a lot of different things. And I guess when I look at this, I look at the numbers, the crunch numbers and everything, we're looking at like 0.5% of our overall budget. It's not, I love the idea of the curriculum ideas, the online courses, a lot of these other things, but I don't know that we want to go into some of the groups that for years we've allowed them to be, you know, we're being a good neighbor to them, they're being a good neighbor to us, and all of a sudden now we're going to say, oh no, we're charging everybody. I see that as having potential negatives for the minimal amount of funds that we're going to get in return. Because it'll be like 0.5% of our budget, if that. 0.5% or 0.1% of our budget. 0.5% or 1% of our budget. Does that make sense?
Yes.
It's a sliver. And it's not going to do anything to stop any of the issues we have.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes. So I have questions about the feeder teams. They're using the high schools mostly, correct?
I'm probably not the best person to answer that because
Ashley says yes.
I would say, what I understand is this, our high schools are utilized almost 100% by our teams. And there are some activities, I know that Ms. Hurt talked about Central, and the reason I mentioned cheer is I think that cheer or dance might be one of the groups that the feeder team is currently using their gymnasium. And so that would be a group that would be charged. But painting with a very broad brush, I think our feeder teams are using other facilities, either the middle schools or someplace else, because our high schools are just used all the time by our activities that are under direct supervision of our coach or sponsor.
So I guess that kind of leads into the question of where's the money from the feeder teams going? Who's benefiting from those feeder teams financially?
So my experience raising my children in the district, Parks and Rec for football, other school districts that are running their facilities, a variety of organizations looking for additional revenue.
So I guess my question more is, so to your point, Mike, that we have all of these other organizations, what if some of those organizations became ours? What if we had a junior wrestling team? Junior football team, and we actually control that stuff in-house rather than just giving away our facilities. And then, I mean, are they official nonprofit status? Who's making that money? There's money being made there, but where's that going? It's not benefiting our students. So I just wonder if that's not something that we ought to look into as well.
Well, if we integrated this program, we would, instead of paying my daughters on the
central feeder team for soccer. So we pay Veta, and we pay Sliza, we pay Skyza. So
the team does, or you personally?
Me personally.
You personally.
You pay for your kid to play, and it's not cheap. It's just like any club soccer. It's a soccer team called Junior, Spartan, whatever high school you're going to.
So are the checks written to the Spartans?
No. They're written to Jeff Brown.
So then Jeff Brown would be the benefactor of?
No.
Okay,
Jeff,
so who would it be?
So
it's wherever you're playing. It's wherever you're playing. Wherever you're practicing at, whatever league you're in.
Well, who pays the coach?
Coach is Don General.
No way.
Yeah.
Well, I'm from the business world, not the education world, so I'm not.
Our coach makes zero money, and my husband is one of them.
Wow.
For junior starting basketball, I don't think it's the same way. I think, like, as of last year, I just know because my dad used to be involved with it, but I'm pretty sure that the coach currently actually does make a little bit of money off of it. And they write checks to junior Spartan basketball and all that. And my current high school coach even like is super involved with the junior Spartans club. So I don't think it would be a bad idea.
Yeah,
soccer
money
is
probably
the
really
so really
really
a bad idea to like maybe pay.
Are we sure of that though? Maybe no. Like she's saying she thinks otherwise. I just think that that might be a conversation and something we ought to look at. If we're going to look at facility rental, we're already doing all of these sporting activities with the students during class time.
So I would offer that we can ask the team to look at that, but that's probably not a part of this current, what they brought to us.
And it might be evolutionary.
Mm-hmm.
So potentially the first step would be making facilities available, which will give you intimate knowledge of who's using the facilities when and how they're organized, which might give you an opportunity to provide a different management structure for those feeder teams that are already using the facility.
So I hold the opinion of we have put forth two tax levies requests that have failed. We developed three teams to investigate different opportunities for additional revenue. This is coming in from the Alternative Revenue Task Force, and I think facility utilization is some of that low-hanging fruit. There's a high need for it, high demand, relatively easy implementation. I think it's a phenomenal idea.
I think that because I'm always different organizations, we're always looking for facilities to do a meeting and to do this, and then you end up doing it in a restaurant you can't hear, and they'll let you have the meeting there, but of course then you all have to eat food and you have, you know, pay that way. So the library is always booked and it takes a long time to get on that schedule to even get a room, which we do get rooms periodically. But I think out there, there are a lot of different things that different organizations, they need different meetings. You know, I can think off the top of my head several different groups that we've looked. And usually you want to meet in someone's house. Well, that just doesn't happen anymore. Everybody's too busy for that. So they're looking for economical, inexpensive. And to me, this is economical. This is inexpensive to be able to use a building for that meeting.
So I think we could get direction from the board on a couple different levels. I think the next step would be timing. So we certainly could bring this forward to the board for something soon, or we could start looking at next school year. It's completely up to the board on how you want us to. We could start planning for next school year. We could start planning for something more immediate.
Next school year's a long time away. I mean, I look at that and think, you know, there's just been a lot of work on it. How much of that changes between now and next year? And
well, so you know that the steps involved would be, first we'd have to identify a person, and that person's first job would be to identify the software and get trained on the software. Then learn about all the things already going on in our district, and get those into the calendar, and begin to really understand what our capacity is. So I think there's a lot of upfront work. If there's, we had talked conceptually that it might be possible to think about this, if we were to have the approval in October, that we might be able to look only at those groups that are first making an application sometime in the spring or late winter. So there may be groups already that have agreed to use the building, you know, every Tuesday night from when to when.
Probably all through the school year.
And so we are going to tackle those groups right away. But maybe somebody wants to just use one facility or something, and they're only going to start in January, February, or April, something like that. We would begin to work them into the schedule that way. So by the time we got to the beginning of the 18-19 school year, we'd kind of be more up and running. And really the critical push comes at each semester break. So once the rentals become available, whatever that date is, July 1 or whatever, there's going to be a huge push to get those in. And then it's going to calm down until you get to January 1 and people are going to want to plan all their spring sports. So we think that there may be opportunity. You know, maybe a perfect schedule would be to get approval in October, get something on board, get some scheduling software in place. We have some ideas already. Get people trained. Begin to filter that in through the early months of 2018 and really be ready for that major push in early July of 2018 when we begin to look to fill all those spaces for the fall and winter sports.
So we could maybe go revenue neutral this year and just break even on getting the person, getting the software, getting everything up to speed, and be, you know, starting that in January as far as implementing.
And you know, I want to be realistic. I think timetable I described probably would be, we probably wouldn't make any money in the 17-18 school year.
Agreed.
Because you're gonna have a person you're
it's
paying for your
well, it'll actually be a cost.
Actually,
so if
a cost.
We hire someone,
but you're
going to pay a salary as they get started out of the gate.
And you have to buy software.
And
right.
The software.
But I was thinking we would start charging in January if that person started in
but
November.
It may not be possible to completely recover all of your costs.
So you're talking about $10,000 in software, some amount of salary.
Filter those in.
And then you have people who have signed up already that we wouldn't go back and undo.
Right.
So
what about finding a sponsor? What about the MasterCard Francis Hall rental program?
What?
I mean, maybe they buy the software. I don't know.
I think that's a whole other study. Talk about.
I do think there's a huge. I think there's opportunity for us to really seek some sponsorships,
mm-hmm.
But that probably should be centered around. A different business plan where you really have a model of what you're going to do. Oftentimes, if you can tie your request to the organization's interest, you're better able to get support. So if you bring them something that seems outside of their interest, it probably isn't going to be successful. But if you can study and figure out what they like to support and bring them a proposal that looks just like that, they're willing to write you a check. And I think we have to do some research around what that might be.
Well, I like the idea a lot, and I think that, you know, anything we can do to generate revenue is a positive. And I think you will be surprised to hear that there's people using our buildings for free. One of the other ideas I saw that I really liked was the bus fee, by the way. Charging for buses, but that's another conversation.
I'll just point out one more quick advantage before you close the conversation, and that is I have concerns about the workload in the activities department at all of our high schools, and this will have the facilities usage, the system that we'll be putting in place will take a little bit off of that.
And I have concerns about starting this year, only because Thorax and Sandy got her basketball team signed up now. not really until December, and I haven't signed up my basketball team until November, December, and now we're charging. And I think there'll be hard feelings, but if we get everything in place, I feel like we should start the fees next year.
And we did ask our buildings to begin to communicate with groups, because again, we had already, by the time we're having these conversations, a lot of the fall and winter things were already signed up for. So we created a standard messaging that was sent out to all of our building administrators to say, the activity, the non-tax revenue task force is working on a plan around rental facilities, and it is possible that beginning as early as January 2018, we may begin to charge a fee. So we haven't identified what that is yet, only to put this, plant the seed in their mind that this may be happening. So that as people make inquiries, we are already planting the seed that this might be.
I can tell you, I found out at my employer from a coworker a month ago. So I know communication is happening.
Were they happy or not?
They were fine with it. They were understanding of it.
Well, to help Patrick here on this, you know, oh, well, I haven't signed my note. I can guarantee you the day, I'll just give an example, Fairmont, when that principal says, okay, all of you groups, you need to come in and fill out all this and find out what days you're using. Every single organization is there to get their time slot, to get the day they want, to be able to use that. They're already doing that. They've already got it for the whole year all planned out.
And this will take us off of the current staff that we have too.
Yes.
That's having to deal with all the after hours stuff.
So it sounds like you're looking for direction for the task force to move forward, as well as permission to hire someone to take on some of the deciding on the software, identify the opportunities for use, and continuing on. So we've heard from most of the people. Mr. Lang, did
yep.
you have your...
Yep. Sounds good.
Mr. Hain, you're not in support, is that...
I mean, anything we could do to raise money, we implemented the young students for activities. We are implementing additional fees for some people that were not. And the total amount of revenue we're talking about is less than, let me make sure I get this correctly, 0.2% of our budget. So it's not a significant amount of money. It's in the overall scope of what we're doing.
Well, I think I heard Mr. Supple different, that the task force did enough information to put together a proposal to see if it was palatable. And that the information is palatable, that the...
$156,000 the first year minus $10,000 minus the employee.
With a potential of $1 million. Once fields are identified, classrooms are identified, that it was my, and maybe I misunderstood, but my understanding was the task force did enough of an estimate to say on the low end, is this palatable? Should we take this forward?
Mrs. Crope, I agree with you, and I would also say for Mr. Hain, I understand your point, because even if we get to where we're raising $1 million a year, it's going to be a very small percentage of our total budget. But
it's $1 million we don't have now.
It's $1 million we don't have now. And it's a step, and it's one of potentially other things that we'll do. And again, the overall objective was to get to that $3 to $5 million a year. And you know, $1 million is pretty aggressive, and it's gonna involve really having to market the facilities. But we think there's potential there. Much as Mrs. Ferguson said, there's a lot of groups that just want a classroom to meet, or a small auditorium, and they're looking for a place to go. They don't want to spend a lot of money. They don't necessarily want to have to buy dinner to do it.
And I think today our investment is a software product and a person.
Yes.
So I think that's low risk to look at a large opportunity.
I think the other thing is, and this will be with other things that we bring forward as well, if this doesn't pan out as planned, you can just stop doing it. And so we're going to, I'm going to tell you, we would have been bringing the software recommendation forward if we need the software. And so your risk is even lower, as I say, because we would be asking for that software. Regardless, we are losing efficiency in hours and time. And so I think the risk is low. And the potential for profit is high. And if it doesn't work out, you have the opportunity to stop.
And we have software.
And software. We're going to have software that I use.
So, Mr. Lane, are you good? Are you concerned? I'm just going to go over.
I'm concerned about January, but I'm okay.
You're concerned about timing, but not the project?
Correct.
Okay, Mrs. Ferguson, I'm good with it. Mr. Hain, are you still uncomfortable? And you may be. I'm just going to go around the table.
I mean, it's something that we're going to do. I'm concerned implementing this year, number one. I agree that it should be something new. Next year, I think we could add some additional cost savings by if we're purchasing a
Mr. Lang?
I'm good.
Mrs. Walker?
I like it.
Mrs. Lang? Ashley?
You get to vote.
So I will add an agenda item to the October meeting, just to formalize the recommendations that I shared with the board earlier this evening, so we can have a vote on that. Is that?
I think that'd be great.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, any other questions, concerns about this topic? All right, superintendent comments.
Sorry, I have a lot of them tonight. I want to begin by updating the board on the progress of strategic planning. This week, the group of 60 met for an entire day. The group identified their own perceptions of the district, reviewed data from different surveys, and was presented an overview of data from all areas of our district. After considering all the day's work, the group developed a list of strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. This work will be shared with the community at upcoming community meetings, as Ms. Lang mentioned earlier.
40.
Community members will have an opportunity to agree, disagree, and add thoughts to the SWOT analysis. While we would like to have people present at the community meetings, lots of people present at those community meetings, we are also preparing a voiced-over presentation and survey for the website. There will be future opportunities for the community to weigh in on the mission and vision, as well as the final plan. I've received much positive feedback about the meeting this week, and especially about the rich conversation with our stakeholders. From my perspective, it was especially beneficial here for our students. The Franks Hall School District, Consley Elementary, have earned a 2017 Partnership District Award from the National Network of Partnership Schools at Johns Hopkins University. Eight Franks Hall School District seniors have been named semifinalists in the 2018 National Merit Scholarship Program. With Hurricanes Harvey and Irma devastating parts of the southern United States, Francis Hall School District students and staff, specifically Becky David, Central Elementary, and Francis Hall High School, have been stepping up and raising thousands of dollars for disaster relief efforts. This week, schools across the district have had a variety of special activities to commemorate Constitution Day, celebrating the signing of the U.S. Constitution on September 17, 1787. Fairmont teacher Stephanie Spallazza is the recipient of the Missouri Lottery's monthly Stars of the Classroom Award for demonstrating excellence in the classroom. Spallazza was also honored to throw out the first pitch, the Cardinals game, on September 8th. Wanted to let the board know Ms. Weitzel is in Kansas City visiting a CAPS program at said team with our hopefully soon-to-be new corporate partners charter. On Saturday, September 9th, Franks Hall held Parent University. Franks Hall has been recently recognized by Johns Hopkins for this exemplary practice. There were over 100 parents who came together with local agencies and our staff to learn on a variety of topics, including preschool literacy, college and career planning, and internet safety. I want to thank Dr. Garland and Jen Henry for their work on this event. In speaking with those in attendance, they were very appreciative of the opportunity and excited about the calendar of speakers we have this year. As you know, the MSBA conference is scheduled for October 6th through 9th. This year, I believe all 7 board members will be in attendance. On behalf of the district, I want to thank you for continuing your learning and for the sacrifices you will make, taking time away from your real jobs and your families to attend the conference with board members from across the state. Francis Hall will also be represented in the form of 2 presentations by our own Dr. Connie Buffman. And then just a reminder, October board meeting is a little off of our schedule. It's on the 12th due to fall break.
Great, thank you very much. Exciting things going on in our district. Okay, next on our agenda is Board of Education requests. Board, do we have any requests? Mrs. Walker.
Okay, so I've got a couple of them. I'd like for us to have an opportunity to talk about the possibility of board members being able to purchase into the district's health insurance.
Oh.
So, haven't heard that before?
No, I've heard that before.
Oh, so I don't, you know, most people don't realize that this is a volunteer position. However, MSBA, where I got the idea, the Missouri School Board Association, said that there are districts that are allowing their board members to purchase the health insurance. So it's, you know, revenue neutral, it doesn't impact the district. So I thought that'd be a good conversation that you could maybe have.
On that topic, so I think, are there other board members interested in adding that to the agenda? Okay, I have a lot of concerns about that, potentially having folks run for the board for the wrong reasons. So in our community today, I think there's some people that are looking for healthcare opportunities,
and some other tax-based entities face concerns where people run for the board or put their name on the ballot in case they get elected, which causes challenges for individuals who are actively and involved in such as a school district. So I have some experience and some concerns with that idea. So I would not be interested in that, but I'm one of seven.
We had looked at it many years ago, and it was just wasn't feasible, and exactly what she was saying, what the consensus was back then.
So my recollection of this part of the agenda from board retreat was, does the board want administration to spend time looking into it in order to make a decision? And so we don't have to make a decision about whether we want to do that. It's just a matter of is it an item that the board would like for administration to look into? Who's doing it? What would the cost be?
Right. Not a decision at this point. Just,
well, yeah, yeah,
just
yeah.
Is there
not even
problem?
Not even put it on
the
agenda. We could
board.
Certainly the option would be to, if you want us to spend some time doing some homework on that item, we could bring it to your board update, add it to the agenda in the future, or not.
If I'm alone, don't spend the time doing it.
Which is why we have this part of the agenda.
And that's exactly what this forum is for.
Yep. I do think that all the other bodies of elected officials, I think the school districts are the only ones that don't get paid and don't have any benefits. So for everybody else that, you know, thinking that people are running for that, all of the municipalities offer it. So I
Not all the fire departments nor the ambulance district or
no, but they get paid per meeting, don't they?
A very small stipend.
Right. Well, it's a small thing. Okay, and
we
then
give you dinner.
That's right. We did give you dinner. Thank you.
But
okay,
Michelle, I don't want to lose that. I want to see if there's other, if there's palette on the board for.
Yeah.
Okay.
Moving on to my number two.
Okay.
We've had several things come up with my own daughter. I think maybe some other board members have had kids. Our cell phone seizure policy is sort of troubling to me, that we can have an adult take a child's phone, and the way that it was put to me by a student that was complaining about it was she felt raped. To have to sit in and watch her principal while she sat there go through all her whole life, it was a very violating feeling. So I'd like for us to have some conversation about how that happens. I think parents should have to agree to that. I mean, my own daughter, I told her, don't give away your passcode. They can take your phone and call me. But I'm very uncomfortable with adults in the district going through students' phones without their parents being aware, present. I don't have a problem taking the phone so the kids can't take things off of it. But I'm concerned that that's happening because the parents aren't aware until conversation
I'd
like.
You know, we've had some conversations with the board in the past, and for several reasons, and our attorney's advice is that we have the ability to seize phones in very limited number of circumstances to do investigations. So we can certainly do a work session on the rationale, why we do it, when we do it.
Yeah, I mean, I
can resend up the brief that was sent out when the question first came up a couple years ago.
Yeah, I remember that. But, you know, the kids aren't getting due process. So if they find something in their phone that's not what they were looking for, the student's in trouble. So kind of like, you know, in a court of law, or they get a search warrant, and they're looking for something, they find something else.
Well, that would be the same thing as principal can go into a locker and search a locker.
But
you might be searching for one thing and find something else.
Right.
The parents aren't.
But the parents don't own the locker. The parents own those phones.
That's true.
I wonder if our technology policies are really up to date. When, you know, are we
We agree with it.
I will tell you that.
Give me a call.
I will tell you that. We and our administrators would feel very strongly that they need to be able to investigate a phone immediately when things are going down in the schools. And again, if, I don't think that this part of our agenda is to debate a topic. It is, do we want to do a work session on it? Do we want to pursue this further? It really is about. So Michelle's bringing an item forward, and do we want to put it on a future agenda to have a discussion about it?
I don't like the legally what our attorneys have to say and what is policy, and really visit that cell phone policy.
Even hear from the principals. I mean, I'm open to hearing from them as to, you know, what that looks like in their day. I'm sure it's not pleasant to have to sit there and do that with a student.
Sounds like a work session topic.
Right.
Looking at the October 12th meeting, we also have the facility rental approval in that meeting. We'll add. Anything else that we need to add to October 12th? November 16th.
In November, we have our school calendar workshop. I didn't see that on the agenda yet. So we will present this 2019-2020 calendar to the community and the staff for a survey in October. And we'll have that ready for the board to review in a workshop setting in November.
In November. Great. Thank you.
We have the academic workshop on there. I'll tell you that is tentative. So with the difficulties with the high school end of course exams this year, the annual APR is going to be delayed possibly beyond November even. There's some talk it'll be after the beginning of the school year, so the accreditation reports from the state might be especially late. I think we leave it on there as a placeholder. See what
it may move out.
It will likely move out.
Thank you.
Okay.
Board, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn the meeting. And thanks for joining us this evening. We've enjoyed having you here.
I'll second that, Michelle.
Motion made by Mrs. Walker, seconded by Mrs. Ferguson.